and the fumbles. It's the one across the hall. If you don't answer, I'll just bring it off the wall. I know he's there, but I just try to call.
We'll be hanging on the telephone. We'll be hanging on the telephone.
I heard your mother, now she's going out the door. Did she go to work or just go to the store? All those things she said I told you to ignore.
See, this is rubber.
Mm-hmm.
Farewell.
In the late 1970s, Blondie's high-energy rock and the glamour of singer Debbie Harry made Blondie one of the world's hottest bands. Their spectacular rise and dramatic fall was one of the sensations of pop history. 16 years later, and now all in their 40s and 50s, they're back together and playing to a home crowd in New York's Madison Square Garden.
Guys, think you like the show? Good. You know, you could talk. They know there's somebody behind the camera. Yeah.
Music for me is not a job, you know, it's a life, you know, it's what I do, and it's what makes me happy. So, I mean, why, if I have to consider it just as, you know, from the career point of view and from the idea of, you know, what the world thinks is the right age for a person to do something, I'm screwed, I'm over, you know, and I'm not over. You know, it's like 25 and you're worthless. You're not, you're dog meat. You know, you might as well be chopped up and put in a can. You know, I fight that. I have to fight that.
We kind of feel like a new band, although it's almost like we were, cryogenically, you know, sealed in some ways, because, you know, we stepped out of a time capsule and all of a sudden we're, people are just as happy to see us as they were back then.
I really love the fact that we all have fans out there that are between 16 and 50. That's amazing. I haven't felt like this since my 20s. I feel really good. I think we've all aged pretty well.
But the road to reunion hasn't been an easy one. When Blondie broke up, they could hardly bear to be in the same room together.
You know, 16 years gone by, I've been with more irritating people than these guys over the years.
Yeah, that's true.
I've spent longer periods with irritating people. So in retrospect, it's not so bad, you know, but I say that about a lot of things. So.
We're all irritating, but we do understand each other's source of irritation more than the other irritating people we've...
And we go right in for those areas.
It's very therapeutic.
Though the lineup has varied over the years, Blondie now is the four founder members. Singer Debbie Harry. Guitarist Chris Stein, her former boyfriend for many years. Drummer Clem Burke. And keyboard player Jimmy Destri. Since reforming, the band has been on the road more or less continuously, playing to packed houses.
It's nice to be working with the guys, you know, the old, you know, my original little family.
After the show in New York, the band, with Chris's wife and two new band members, set off to play a benefit concert near Chicago in aid of Tibet.
This would have been like a limousine to eat, but they looked good for the public, so we hired this shitty band.
No, we wanted those Buddhist bastards to know how sincere we were.
Yeah.
This is not just a nostalgia tour of greatest hits. At shows like these, the band play new songs to an audience, many of whom weren't even born when Blondie Mania was at its height.
Following my lust for wonder, everywhere I've ever been, I can't escape from the sound of it, the sound of my screaming skin.
Freedom Festival. Tibet, the small country up in the Appalachian Mountains. The Appalachians being the Black Hills of Kentucky. These guys have been stuck there for years, right in the middle.
Take three.
Hello. Go on in.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
Hello. I'm Debbie.
Hello.
Nice to meet you. Tilt shop.
The Beastie Boys talked us into coming here, spending 3.5 hours in a dirty, shitty van with the rain leaking down on us. If only to play a half-assed, half-hour set to get our picture taken with three Tibetan monks. That was the high point of the whole thing so far, as far as I'm concerned. Because all those guys have had the kundalini coming up through their chakras and exploding out of their thousand-petal lotus.
What is the concert for?
I haven't the slightest idea. It's for us making fools of ourselves once again in public.
This is who the concert is for, so this gentleman could return to his people and really become their spiritual leader, the Dalai Lama. The Dalai Lama.
Though Blondie is the name of the band, not the singer, what has always made them special is the punk charisma of their singer, Debbie Harry. Born in 1945, Debbie Harry grew up in the suburbs outside New York in Hawthorne, New Jersey, the adopted daughter of a gift shop owner and his wife.
Just keep the dial on 1430, that's W-I-O, wonderful radio.
So whatever you do,
I always knew that I was adopted as a small girl, as a tiny girl. And I think that this always raised questions in my mind about, you know, my identity and sort of made me want to search for myself. And so I fantasized in many ways, and one of my fantasies was that, you know, Marilyn Monroe was my mother, because I thought that she was so brilliant on screen and so fascinating as a star.
In Marilyn Monroe biographies of that period, there was some talk about her having had possibly an illegitimate child, unknown. You know, this was the big thing. It was sort of known that she had had a child, but had given the child away. That's the point right there. So with that knowledge, I mean, Debbie then could run along with the thought that maybe it was me, you know? it had a lot of influences on her. It made her feel like somewhat alien, somewhat alienated. But it also gave her a kind of hope that she might in the future become someone like Marilyn Monroe.
She went to Hawthorne High School, where she sang in the choir and twirled a baton for her class in the school majorettes. She was nicknamed Moon because of her broad oval face. But when she graduated in 1963, she was voted prettiest girl of her year.
I was bleaching my hair. I've always been bleaching my hair. And as a child, I was called Blondie. You know, as little girls are often called Blondie. You know, my dad called me Blondie. The first song I ever wrote was called Platinum Blonde, which is about my fascination with the silver screen and the stars, the blonde stars. And I think it all just sort of came to me in a flash.
I wanna be a platinum blonde. Ooh. Just like all the sexy stars. Marilyn, Jean, Jane, Maya, Marlene. Yeah, they really have fun. In a luminescent day glow shade. Walk into a bar and I'll have it made. Cause if that's all it takes.
I felt like everyone does that grows up in suburbia or, you know, like in a small town that's very confining and, you know, everybody's in your face, everybody knows everybody else's business.
See you later.
I really wanted to have some anonymity and some experiences that would be inspiring or nourishing or expanding or something like that. You know, I wanted to be an artist. How can you be an artist in a small town? So that's why I came here.
In the mid-60s, Debbie Harry gravitated to New York's Greenwich Village, at that time a mecca for underground artists and rock bands. For several years, she worked as a waitress and looked for openings in the movie and music business. She was a bunny girl at the Playboy Club and spent a year with a folk group called the Wind in the Willows. In the early 70s, she fell in with a girl trio, the Stilettos.
Well, we were doing a little show with the Stilettos, the three babes, right? The three babes on the pool table, singing our little asses off. And so, you know, we had invited friends. I mean, the only audience you could get, of course, was the poor friends had to come. So the friends would come and they were there. And so we did our little show. And one of the people in the audience was this, you know, sort of exotic looking man with long black hair and lots of eye makeup and jewelry and everything. And I thought, wow, it's an interesting character. And so we met afterwards and seemed to have a real sort of instant rapport. But now I understand, you know, what that really is about. And it's Chris, you know, he's a very charming person. And so then he joined the band. He became the bass player. And then he was the guitar player. So, you know, then he worked with the Stilettos. And then we split off and formed our own band.
They put an ad in the Village Voice, which is the local paper here in New York, and I think it was words to the effect, wanted a high-energy freak drummer. And little did they know what they were getting, and I soon went and met with them. I think they auditioned a few drummers prior to my audition, but I think they liked my shoes. I don't think I actually played the drums for the audition. I think we just had a chat.
I think it was Debbie who came over to me one day and said, you know, and I was bursting for this, was dying to hear this, you know, we need a piano player. And I said, well, I don't have a piano.
And I brought this little Farfisa organ on my back practically because I had no car, and I brought it to a rehearsal. It wasn't an audition so much as it was a rehearsal. It was like, you're in, you got the right haircut, like the way you dress, now play these songs.
At the heart of the New York underground in the mid-70s was CBGB's, a club on what was then New York's Skid Row, the Bowery. On its famously filthy stage and back rooms, a noisy revolution was underway. Turning their backs on the pop establishment, bands like the Ramones, Television, and Talking Heads were bringing energy and anarchy back into music. The seeds of punk were being sown.
It would be very, very hot and very smoky, and the walls would perspire. And there was this very narrow spot next to the stage where everybody would disappear into the back room, into the bathroom, downstairs. No dressing room, piles of equipment everywhere. A lot of shoving and carrying on and dancing in the front. It was the kind of venue where if you were on the front of the stage, yeah, you could touch the people in the front row. Whatever kind of excitement you generated there went a long way. We were all jealous because she was in another band and not in ours.
They were not thought of as a stellar live attraction at CBGB, certainly, and were not taken seriously by the other bands at all. Nobody thought that they would ever make it. You know, if you were to say at CBGB's, if they had like a yearbook annual, least likely to succeed, everybody would have nominated Blondie.
You know, some people would be very critical and say, you know, she's cute, but she can't sing. And you'd learn later that that was just some sour grapes.
Well, she took a lot of flack for her beauty in the CBGB's days. There was a famous shot of Debbie that was reprinted a number of times in magazines at CBGB's, where she'd fallen over on the stage and her dress was hiked up so you could see her panties. And the Ramones always said, well, we don't have any panties to show people.
I guess the idea that, you know, there was a girl fronting a rock band, I think that, and a lot of guys really found that disturbing. You know, that they really felt that this was male territory exclusive. And that, you know, I should go back to the suburbs.
Bye-bye, sugar.
But despite the punk image, the band had wildly differing tastes.
Chris and I are definitely coming from that, you know, aesthetic kind of art world, and Clem in particular is very, 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 very pop. You know, I mean, his world is, you know, when we met him, he had a room, literally a room from floor to ceiling stacked with teen magazines and pop magazines. His, you know, that was it. And it still is, you know, I mean, he's really devoted to that. And he knows a lot about it, you know, he's really, really firmly in love with that. And I think, you know, Jimmy is sort of a loose cannon. In a lot of ways, you know, I think that he sort of bounces back and forth between the two. I really sort of, I don't know if Jimmy's world is yet to be defined, actually. Oh, don't tell him I said that.
Debbie's probably the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. As soon as I saw her, there's something about, she had this big head and dimples. A little clumsy on stage, beautiful voice, which has gotten better over the years. And just totally sweet. She was really totally sweet to us. She used to treat us like children, you know? Make sure you guys don't stay out late. Don't drink too much. We have a show tomorrow, you know? And at the same time, we were all in love with her, you know, all enraptured by her. But at the same time, she was like your big sister.
If they were going to play music together, they decided they should live together. The band moved into an apartment that Chris and Debbie had rented on the Bowery, just along from CBGB's.
This is it. This is 266 Bowery. This is Blondie headquarters. And we were on that floor. The equipment would be set up right by the windows. And this was it. This was our home. This is where everything happened here. I mean, we would bring our equipment out every night and wheel it in carts across the CBGBs whenever we played there. This is the doorway, the stairway. I don't know about who's living here now, but it brings back memories. We used to use a lot of Chinese chalk, which is to keep cockroaches at bay. And we used to draw marks of delineation around one another's beds so the roaches would step in the chalk and just die, so they'd stay off your bed. And we'd wake up in the morning and there'd be these, like, infantry lines of dead roaches all around, you know, try and breach the line, you know, and they'd be dead all around the bed. And that's about all I could say about this place, except that I spent maybe two of the best years of my life in this building. It's great.
Everybody was fighting to get their ideas heard at the same time, and it would get, you know, quite physical, and, you know, there wouldn't be a day that wouldn't go by without the start of some kind of major argument about something, you know, but it was like a family kind of thing. And that chaos actually added to the atmosphere of when everything would work. And you'd find that in 1976, and you'd find it in 1998, 99 as well.
Last year, in an attempt to recapture the family atmosphere of the early days, the band decided to make their reunion album at Chris's apartment.
It was essentially the same kind of room, almost the same exact pieces of equipment and shrunken heads and things that were in the old loft were in the new place. And we'd start all over again with everybody having a big old argument on Monday morning about something, and Craig, wait outside while we have this important argument.
Let's go.
And they'd have a major argument for an hour or two, and you hear things flying around, and then we get down to work.
Let's go.
The rock here, amazingly enough, I found it in a dumpster in the garbage here in fashionable Tribeca, and I've always been astonished that somebody would throw the damn thing out, because what it is, it's a big piece of quartz, and if you went into a gem store, of which there are plenty, it would probably cost about $2,000. But I did find it in a dumpster, and it says something to me about the kind of people that live in the area here. And then also, quartz is known for absorbing electrical impulses, so we have it hanging here in the studio to absorb all the negative ions and protons or what have you. Clem hit his head on it a few times, or no, Jimmy.
She used to have this little Camaro, 1966 Camaro. And she would drive everywhere, and she'd put all the drums in the car and drive them to the gig, and come back and get the guitars and drive them to the gig. And this is the star. This is the one who we knew was going to be the star. But this is what she wanted to do. This was her way of relaxation, I guess. She loved to drive.
Blondie were a very downtown collection of individuals, and they had a lot of different interests in art and pop art, cartoons, comics. Chris had always photographed Debbie in a way, often as a cartoon character, and she fit very well into the sensibility of Punk magazine. You know, as a cartoon, she has kind of an exaggerated look to her with a large head, and you know, lends herself to the whole cartoon thing.
In fact, the name of the band referred not just to Debbie's hair, but to an icon of homely American respectability.
In America, Blondie was a very attractive homemaker cartoon character, a woman who took care of the house, and her husband was this guy named Dagwood Bumstead, who was always getting into trouble, you know, with his boss, or, you know, tries to mow the lawn and the lawnmower breaks, and, you know, that type of thing. Blondie was always coming to his rescue one way or the other in a really cute way, and she was kind of an average American woman.
It was very smart of them to have this very, very smart, brainy girl up at the front pretending to be kind of a bimbo. She wasn't really pretending, she was just, you know, spoofing on what came naturally, but and kind of clowning with it. But it worked.
Blondie's affectionate but ironic take on pop culture caught the eye of the ringmaster of the New York art scene, Andy Warhol.
Andy and Debbie really got along, and also Chris. Even from the beginning, it was his encouragement, because he had been to CB's before I was there. Andy, he was talking about, oh, I sat on this chair and the whole chair collapsed underneath me. It was so bad, it was so terrible, there was no place to sit down. Of course, he loved it, and the fact that this is the place that they were coming from, here's this beautiful, glamorous person, and there she's in this thing, so that appealed to him immediately.
Warhol did a portrait of Debbie that echoed his famous picture of Marilyn Monroe.
It was one of his best. It really was. He was so happy with it. He was so happy with making it. And it was Andy who actually, like, went over it and picked out the dots on that acetate sheet. He was so involved with that picture.
In 1976, Blondie finally won a contract with Chrysalis Records, but they were considered too raw for the American market and were sent off on a lengthy world tour. In Europe, they were rapturously received by a flourishing punk and new wave audience.
This was a time where everything in England was closed due to industrial dispute. Yeah, everybody was out of work. I mean, it was a perfect climate for artistic upheaval. Perfect, that's what you want, you know? The time when with the squatters and this and that, and that whole thing was starting to build up, and it was starting to become bands, and, you know, and it was great to see. I mean, we arrived at a time when we were there, we were something for them, that we were their lollipop, you know, in a way.
Got a good sound to start off Top of the Pops this week. It's Blondie and a number called Denis. Oh,
Denis was a hit all over Europe and shifted the Blondie image from punk to pop. Through 77 and 78, they had a string of hits. Blondie mania had arrived.
Not
done.
were a lot more famous in the UK than we were here. But as far as having some sort of recognition, maybe Notorious would be a good thing for me. Certain notoriety that the boys had, you know, that was like when we walked into a club, people stopped talking a bit and looked at you, you know, and we were able to get on guest lists and stuff like that. That Clem used that a lot. I just like the vibe of like walking into a club or a restaurant and getting that, you know, that was good. That was really good. That was something I worked for all my life, just to get that little bit of, hey, there he is. Yeah, that was really cool.
The media obsession with Debbie was obviously going to happen. Debbie was kind of like the new Bowie or the new Mark Bolan, or, you know, there was a time when there was kind of a void in pop music, and I think Debbie really did fill that, and the fact that she was a woman made it even that much more intriguing.
The media focused on Debbie in the beginning, and the relative fame she achieved compared to us, of course, sparked some jealousy and stuff, you know. We're only human, you know. I mean, we all thought we were four relatively handsome young lads, you know, we should get some recognition ourselves. It was so out of proportion to what we got that it created some jealousy.
It's very difficult when somebody comes to interview the group and one of the musicians says, oh, I'll do it, and is told, no, they don't want to talk to you, they want to talk to Debbie.
But the peak of Blondie's fame was still to come. Despite adulation in Europe, real success in America had so far eluded them. All that changed with their third album, Parallel Lines. The album sold over 20 million copies.
Parallel Lines was sort of the first record that was a real album in the way that, you know, Ziggy Stardust or Beggar's Banquet or some of these other things that I admired was considered, with a, you know, a bunch of hit songs off it, and was less of just a novelty thing, and was accepted on a lot of levels. It was probably the first one that crossed over into a lot of different areas and got us away from being labeled just punk or whatever it was.
Blondie, and Debbie in particular, shot from cult to celebrity status. The old fantasy about Marilyn Monroe was finally coming true.
I've been very fortunate that I sort of was born with a great face, and, you know, I didn't really want to change anything. I think that I've just sort of done a few things to stop the sags. It comes with the territory, right? I mean, my face is my fortune, and I think that, you know, people want to see me looking good, and I want to see myself looking good. My finest hour, oh yeah. All I want, and I'm working it, babe.
You know how they make these? You know how this is made? They take a Barbie, and they take off the head, and they put the head in an oven. And when it gets melted, they blow into the neck. They expand the head a little. Then they go like this in the cheeks. Then they give it attitude.
I don't want to go out.
Can we see it, Jimmy?
Debbie. Okay,
Jimmy, look.
Try it.
No.
Can we get the Chris model? Chris model talks.
I don't want to be here.
The Clem model talks too. Its head goes like this.
I don't know.
What is yours, DJ?
Mine gets fondled.
I don't know why he was leaving.
Mine gets fondled too much. They discontinued it.
But the euphoria of stardom was short-lived. Even as Blondie seemed to have it all, the creative tensions within the band were beginning to turn nasty.
Chris was fighting a lot with Jimmy. I remember he told me one day he just wanted to put Jimmy in a closet and close the door and lock it. And I remember him saying that. We're going to put you in the closet and lock the door. You know, shut up.
The idea of all of the group being on a tour bus, the fact they weren't getting along that well, there were different factions developing, it just probably would have been a recipe for disaster. So they had this brainstorm to tour in separate limousines, which actually maybe that would have worked, but nobody ever went with that. This picture to me captured the sort of burnout phase when, you know, things were becoming a little less fun and more stressful, and that time when it was just beginning, the beginning of the end, and this was only in 1979, so, you know, it was a long ending, I guess.
The more successful we got, the more estranged we became from one another. I mean, at the height of our success, I probably saw the other members of the band a handful of times. A lot of people in the band were sort of damaged by being on the road so much in the early days and not really making any money doing it. And when the time came when we could actually go out there and earn a fair amount of money doing it, no one was really interested in doing it.
In order to continue and to carry on together, you know, we really had to, you know, forgive and forget. I think I probably had, you know, some anger and some things to resolve, you know. I think that that's probably a lot what the song Forgive and Forget is about. So, you know, for me, that song is particularly poignant and inspirational, you know, with regards to the Blondie reunion. Being in Blondie is a very unique experience, you know, and it's something that beyond each other, you know, it's sort of like you have to respect the experience.
Look, industrious people, creating things, building shelters, lean-tos.
Just the wombles.
Collecting firewood. Yeah.
So now, all of a sudden, you know, we're back together and, you know, we have this sort of backlog of hits and, you know, we're playing the big shows and it really is exciting. It's a mutual appreciation, believe me. To walk on stage and, you know, to hear that sound, you know, that wonderful, you know, sort of screaming, kind of thunderous sound, and to know that, you know, that's, you know, why we're all together, you know, everybody's, you know, there for the same reason. Of course, it's extremely wonderful.
By the early 80s, despite two more successful albums, Blondie had reached breaking point. But the band was still under contract to produce one more record. The result was The Hunter.
I don't remember the
Hunter Sessions that well at all. And it's probably because I was getting ill and doing drugs and whatever at the time.
But I remember, you know, there was a lot of tension in the studio back then. I remember, I can't say what I remember about that stuff. I really can't. There was a lot of tension.
When I look at the cover of The Hunter, I really see faces there that are almost garishly made up and are not who the people are. If you look at Debbie, she's wearing some incredible weird hairdo that's just not her. And I do think that they were not a band anymore when they made The Hunter, and that's why the music is weaker.
The title of the single from the album, Island of Lost Souls, proved an unwitting description of a band that seemed to have lost its way. Here is what
we do. We kind of imploded. I mean, the last tour that we did, it was very ironic because we really didn't want to be around each other. Yet we found ourselves on a private jet. Now, if you've ever been on a private jets aren't very big unless you own, you know, a private 747, unless you're the Prime Minister or the President of the United States. So, although we didn't want to be around each other, after the shows, we would find ourselves face to face on this private jet like this, like looking at each other, you know, and it was really diabolical. It was just not a very happy time.
Exhaustion and drugs were taking their toll on Chris, whose appearance during this final tour hinted at serious trouble to come.
And then Chris got sick, and we couldn't find out what it was. It went on for quite some time with no diagnosis, and he kept getting worse and worse and worse.
I got weaker and weaker, and then suddenly my mouth broke out, and it got harder to eat. I had all these sores inside my mouth. And then I later found this is all part of the snowballing effect of the condition. And, you know, your inability to intake nourishment makes you weaker, et cetera, and so forth. And then gradually you break out the binding of your skin, the whatever it is, proteins or stuff that bind your skin together break down. And you just break out all over the place and your skin falls off.
Chris's illness was diagnosed as pemphigus, a rare and potentially fatal disease. It ended the career of a band that had ceased to exist creatively.
I don't think any of us really pulled together at that point. I was very concerned about him, but I didn't show it. And I feel really, to this day, I feel bad about that.
Although Chris eventually recovered, he wasn't yet free of drugs.
The whole time that I was finished, was getting high and then spent a lot of time trying to figure out why I had been getting high and a very introspective period for me. I was, did a lot of looking into myself because I was like a big pothead from when I was a teenager on into my 30s. I smoked pot like every day. I experimented with harder drugs and all that stuff.
I was just appalled, at what Chris was doing to himself. And I got to the point where I just said, Debbie, this is not the Chris Stein, the brilliant Chris Stein that was. She heard what I was saying, but she also said she would never abandon him.
But in the end, having stood by him throughout his illness and recovery, Debbie broke off the relationship.
When Chris and Debbie separated, which was in 1987, they separated the same day that Andy Warhol died. Remember, Debbie told me Chris called her up and said, you always had good timing, and now you've done it again,
She would never elaborate, because even today, it's too painful for her. But it was a death and fear of Chris's death that prompted that move.
After the collapse of Blondie in 1983, the members of the band pursued other careers in music. It looked as though Blondie had been laid to rest. Then last year, the founding members decided to give it another go.
I think maybe everyone's felt there was a bit of unfinished business to do. I mean, certainly money was one of the motivations with our reunion. I mean, that's obvious. But also, when we decided to reunite, it was very important for us to make new music. We found as though when we decided we wanted to write songs together and go into the studio together, we found as though there was a chemistry there for us that had been missing in our individual musical careers.
They took on two new musicians, Paul Carbonara on guitar and Lee Fox on bass, and began to rehearse.
I think if we're doing anything that's revolutionary at this point, it's having a good reunion thing, because a lot of reunions have come and been embarrassing for the parties involved.
If we had stayed together, we would have put out, you know, stock, boring records. We would have lost our edge, and we would have just done it to do it, you know, done it to make some money. And I'm glad we took the time off, because we came back hungry again.
Chris has recently married. Debbie has remained single.
They still carry on a commitment that will never fail. They still call each other every day.
We shared in an experience that is very unusual, you know, his insights and his precision and his logic and my instinct and my, you know, emotional take on the world. You know, we really are one terrific person together, you know. We should probably be sewn together and somehow, you know, I don't know.
It's a real love story, but sometimes, you know, the people who are bonded forever only have a short time where everything gels in perfection. Otherwise, it only happens in the movies.
Great to see Chris is all completely better now, and it really doesn't feel as though 16 years or 17 years has passed, and we realize that we do have a bond between us, and we are a family, a dysfunctional family at best, and I think we actually do enjoy being around one another right now.